So welcome to St. Paul on a kind of a snowy Sunday morning. I would imagine that we've got maybe more people watching online. So if that's you, welcome. I'm glad to have you. If you're watching from home, I hope you still have your slippers and your cup of coffee. And boy, that sounds good, doesn't it? So yeah, okay. But it's good to be here with the, where you get to interact with others. So we're glad you're with us. Welcome to guests who are here. We're delighted to have guests with us. And for everybody who is present, we ask you, please, there's a white card in front of you. Fill it out and put that in the offering plate. We're going to receive the offerings later on. And if you have a prayer request or something to praise God for, fill out the yellow card and put that in the offering plate. And then we'll get that, and I can include that in today's prayers. If you're a guest, if you leave some contact information like an email address or a phone number, that lets us just be in touch with you to just share what's going on so that you can say, yeah, I want to plug into that, or no, that's not for me, okay? So that's no pressure, all right? Well, we're glad you're with us. This is the first Sunday after Epiphany. Epiphany was when the wise men came to visit Jesus, and we mark that on every year on January 6th, which was yesterday. And Jesus was a little kid then, you know, the wise men came. And then the first Sunday after, he's 30. That's how quickly it goes, you know. And it's Jesus' baptism. And so you'll hear about the baptism today in some of the songs. And the deal with baptism is that God, we don't have to choose him. He comes to us. And in baptism, it gives you the certainty because he's working through the word and the water. It's an event where you know that he's forgiving you. You know that he's claiming you as his child, his son, his daughter. And so the Bible uses the phrase in Christ. You are in Christ. Your whole life is tied up with what Jesus has done for you. And you want to live for him. You're in Christ. And that'll come through today in today's service too. We're going to be starting a series called Killing It. And Killing It, you'll hear, is about really living in Christ. Well, I invite you to stand. And our first song is one where we invite God to come to us. Open the eyes of my heart. Maybe that's familiar to you. Let's join in singing.
I want to see you.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. God, we come today and we want to worship you, who you are. You're the only real living God, your Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We thank you for who you are. And we ask you to come near to us right now, this morning, in this place. Forgive our weak commitment to you in the past. You're worthy of our total love, our total commitment, because of your deep and your constant love and your commitment to us. And so open our hearts, open our minds, that we can trust you more and we can live for you boldly. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's join in singing One Thing Remains. Seated now, and we continue as we hear God's word for us today.
Good morning. The first reading is taken from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11. Dead to sin and alive to God. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin, once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The New Testament reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Paul writes to all people everywhere who call on the name of the Lord Jesus. This letter is from Paul, chosen by the will of God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus, and from our brother Sosthenes. I am writing to God's church in Corinth, to you who have been called by God to be his own holy people. He made you holy by means of Christ Jesus, just as he did for all people everywhere who call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. The gospel reading is taken from Mark chapter 1, verses 4 through 11. Jesus is baptized. John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist, ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." This is God's word for us today.
Thank you, Brian. We do have kids' church, but I think that might be a little bit too young for you. Is that okay? I think you'd be more comfortable here. So, good? All right. So we're going to go on with today's message, and we're going to focus on that second lesson, that New Testament lesson that Brian read from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And I want to kind of talk to you today about a phrase, and it's a phrase that we don't use a lot here in the Midwest, and the phrase is killing it. You ever heard that? You're killing it. And killing it means having a ripped body, a cool fashion style, career success, high level of achievement, going on these envy-producing vacations, having fabulous hair, and an immense personal charm. And I did a little search online, and I found out, just killing it, Beyoncé. She's killing it after racking up the most Grammy Awards for her music than any other woman ever has. And Kim Kardashian, she's killing it. She's a reality TV star, an entrepreneur, a mother of four. She sold a chunk of her KKW Cosmetics for $200 million, and her Skims clothing brand is worth $3.2 billion. She's also studying to become a lawyer to work towards prison reform. Elon Musk, he's killing it. He's the innovator who started Tesla, SpaceX, Starlink. He owns X, which was formerly Twitter. He is the richest man in the world. Elon Musk is killing it. Now, here in Amherst, we tend to have a kind of a calmer lifestyle. Nevertheless, everybody wants to succeed. Everybody wants to do the best they can. And so to some extent, you and I, we're killing it. So even at church, people want to know that they're doing it right, that they're killing it. So I want you to turn to the person who's near you, if you will, and just say to them real quickly, "Thou art killing it." Go ahead. Okay. Doesn't that feel good? Thou art killing it. All right. Now, killing it ends up involving a whole lot of pressure because, you know, we all know about this. I compare other people's Instagram life to my own real dull life, my ordinary life. And then I wonder, are my kids killing it? Are my abs killing it? Is my hair killing it? Is my resume killing it? Is my vacation killing it? Plus, there's the problem that once you're killing it, it doesn't stay killed. You know, you got to kill it again tomorrow. And the drive to be killing it leads people to overwork, to addictions, to envy. And we all know about this, about the anxiety, the depression, the isolation, the exhaustion, the feelings of worthlessness, feelings of failure. In fact, killing it, it's killing us. So I want to take you today to a city where they kind of invented killing it. And then they learned one day about a whole different way to live. And we can learn that too. And the city is called Corinth. And I kind of want to walk through some of the facts and the history of Corinth so you can all see the incredible relevance to your life, to our church, to the times that we live in. Corinth was located in Greece, and you can see that it's on this dot, it's on this tiny strip of land, this isthmus, between a larger body of land to the north, east, and to a larger body of land to the south. And on one side, on the right, there is a harbor, and that harbor would lead towards Asia. And on the other side of the city is a harbor that would lead towards Italy and Europe. And so this was this incredibly strategic piece of land for trade. The Roman peace, Rome ruled all the world, the Pax Romana, meant global trade was available on an unprecedented scale, and that would mean unbelievable wealth for people in this city. This was going to be a gold mine. And Julius Caesar, he rebuilt Corinth basically from scratch just a couple decades before Jesus' time. So in other words, if we were to use today's language, Corinth was a startup. And it had the whole culture of a startup, this unconventional stuff. And Caesar, he populated it with ex-soldiers and freedmen who were formerly slaves, ex-slaves. So that meant there was no landed aristocracy, no nobility. And that meant that the people were just this mob of hungry, scrappy, highly ambitious risk takers who were dissatisfied with the old ways and the old traditions, and they were driven to leverage new opportunities. And that in turn attracted entrepreneurs from Greece and Italy and Egypt. And they infused new capital. And that meant that there was generating wealth. And so in Paul's day, when he gets there, many Corinthians had very serious fortunes. And that in turn made the real estate market go crazy. If you wanted to get rich, go to Corinth and buy real estate. Flip houses there and you will be rich. Also, Corinth was this center of innovation. Because it was new, Rome's best city planners created the city, and one ancient writer said that it had the most sophisticated water distribution system in the ancient world. And in the Mediterranean, getting water is a big issue. And that innovation, in turn, reinforced this belief that, get this, they believed human ingenuity, they believed that technology could solve any problem that people had. Sound familiar? And they just were intensely proud and intensely self-sufficient. The first travel guide in history was written right around the time that Paul lived. And this ancient writer was kind of like the Rick Steves of the ancient world. And he dedicates a big chunk of this book to Corinth. And he wrote that it was believed that a son of Zeus, you know, the god Zeus, that a son of Zeus named Corinthus was the one who originally founded Corinth. And that kind of gave the people the sense that that city was magic. It was a divine place. And with these two harbors, well, that brought a lot of sailors. And you know what the reputation is of sailors who come to port on leave? Well, they would come with lots of money and they would blow it on liquor and sex. And so Corinth had this attitude of anything goes sexual expression. It was this vulgar party city. And another Greek writer named Aristophanes, he said promiscuous sex was so associated with Corinth that he made up a word, Corinthianize, and that meant sexual activity. And then Plato, a big writer from back then, he talked about a woman of Corinth, meaning any prostitute. So that was the red light district of the world. You know, what happens in Corinth stays in Corinth. And in terms of religion, Corinth was extremely pluralistic. Archaeologists, they found temples to over 26 different gods there. And then all these immigrants and all these sailors will be bringing their religions and their gods into the city, including some people from this little no-name kind of country called Israel, and they brought a religion of a god named Yahweh. By St. Paul's day, Corinth was very clearly the future. And that was so true that when the Roman government made Greece one of their colonies, they didn't choose historic ancient Athens to be the capital. They chose Corinth. See, Athens, their best days were all behind them. Corinth, best days were all in front of it. It's kind of like these days here in our country. Companies are moving their people and their business out of California and Washington State and Chicago in the Northeast, and they're all headed to Texas. And so Dallas and San Antonio and Austin, that's the future. And Corinth was like that. And there was this ceaseless building always going on there. And every project, every monument had inscriptions that would promote the status of the person who built it. One man, a man named Babius, he had a fountain built in Corinth as a monument to himself. And he wrote on it, chiseled into it, Babius paid for this monument out of his own wealth and approved it by his own authority as a city magistrate. And just to make sure that nobody missed it, he had that inscription chiseled in there twice. And the number of those inscriptions in Corinth was really just staggering. One author writes, Corinth was a city where public boasting and self-promotion had become an art form. What a weird society. Can you imagine a place where people would publicly post their accomplishments and their honors and their experiences and their possessions in order to be seen and liked by other people? What a weird place that must have been. Can we relate? Yeah. Those inscriptions were to the Corinthians like what social media is to us today. And over these next few weeks, we're going to look at all of this because, see, these were real people. And they were like you and I today. And they just wanted a flourishing life, just like we do today. And it seemed to them, back then, that wealth and status and honor, reputation, security, being beautiful, being healthy, that those were the bringers of that flourishing life, just like what is happening in our society today. And into this great city of unprecedented wealth and super competitive and hyper-sexualized, status-obsessed, religiously pluralistic, untethered, leaving tradition behind, one day there came this tent maker, a guy named Paul, and he spoke of an alternative to this ambition for superficial worldly things. And the Bible book of Acts tells us about Paul's coming there. It said, after this, Paul left Athens and he went to Corinth, and there he met a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, who had recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla because Claudius was the Caesar. Claudius had ordered all the Jews to leave Rome. When Paul went to see them, he went because he was a tent maker as they were, and he stayed and worked with them. Now, the fact that Paul is a tent maker is important because tent making, to be bent over and sewing tents out of leather or canvas, that was considered to be real menial, low-status work. And that's Paul. He stayed with tent makers. He lived in their home, which would have also doubled as their workshop. And you have to picture Paul teaching while he's doing this, because sometimes people think of Paul coming to the town and he's kind of like, you know, this celebrity, and he can walk around with crowds of people and just drop pearls of spiritual wisdom and everybody's soaking in. But no, he's multitasking. He would have been working at his craft and trying to teach people as he's doing that. And here's the thing. Paul didn't have to do this. Paul had an education. He had a brilliant mind. He was deeply literate in the Hebrew scriptures and in all the ancient literature. And he was a Roman citizen, for crying out loud. He could have come as this brilliant lecturer supported by wealthy patrons. And there were people who wanted to give him money to do that. But Paul refused them. And instead, he comes as a low-status, tent-making slave, and he proclaims a carpenter killed on a cross. Paul was a man of status who gave it all up for a low status. And he came telling about a story of another man of high status who gave it all up, and that man's name was Jesus. And Paul would write, who, though in very nature God, took on the likeness of a human being and became a servant, and he humbled himself even to death on a cross. And here's how Paul starts this letter to this people. He said, Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people, together with all those everywhere who call in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And what jumps right out is that he gives the names Jesus Christ, Lord, 11 times in just three short verses. Paul's preoccupied with this man. I mean, how weird is this? In Corinth, Paul comes, and his hero is a carpenter who died a shameful death, a person who was rejected by his society, a despised criminal. Jesus was a failure by every conventional standard. And Paul is convinced that Jesus is not only the revelation of who God is, so if you want to know God, you look to Jesus, but Paul also teaches that Jesus is the expression of a human flourishing life. So if you want to know what it's really like to live a full human life, you look to Jesus Christ. And on the cross, Jesus, he put to death sin and guilt and hell and mortality that had been destroying the human race. Jesus, he's really killing it. And then they put Jesus in this tomb and they roll a big stone in front of the tomb. And the people in Corinth would be hearing that because the Corinthians, they had this myth, this legend, that the first king of their city was a guy named Sisyphus, and that name might ring a bell for you. But it was believed that after he died in death, Sisyphus was condemned to roll a huge boulder up a giant hill, and every time he got that enormous boulder almost to the top of the hill, it would slip from his grasp and roll all the way back down, and he would have to trudge back down and roll it back up again. And this goes on and on and on throughout eternity. And that story captivated writers and artists, and it still does. Albert Camus wrote The Myth of Sisyphus, and it's this expression of despair, of meaninglessness, an expression of life that is just exhausting and pointless and empty. And you see, in Corinth, there was all this wealth and all this power and status, but there was also this despair that none of that was meaningful. And that despair was pictured by this endless rolling of this stone. And then Paul comes and he speaks of Jesus, and Jesus rolled a stone too. Jesus just moved his stone one time and it stayed moved. And it's not a picture of despair. It's a picture of immense victory. And Paul says, Jesus, he's the bringer of a new way of life. Jesus is another shot at the human race. In his resurrection, Jesus is starting a new way to be human. The pathway to human flourishing is not through accumulation and wealth and success and status and self-sufficiency. Human flourishing is through surrender to God and humility and generosity and love. Jesus' crowd, the people he gathers, are carpenters and they're tent makers and they're slaves for God's sake. And a few wealthy people, yeah, they were slave and free, Jew and Gentile, male and female, rich and poor. And Paul becomes the poster boy for this because he used to have the name Saul. And the name Saul was the name of the first king of Israel, a name of great pride for Hebrew people. And the Hebrews also had this pride, the Jews had the pride that they were better people than anybody else on the planet. And instead of seeing himself as superior, he gives that all up. And he identifies with people that he once despised. And so as Paul, he dedicates his whole life to embracing a whole world of people whom Jesus loves and died for. And Paul mentions he's an apostle. And in Corinth, They would at least expect him to mention that he's not just an apostle, but he's the greatest apostle, because after all, he wrote more books in the New Testament than anybody else, and he doesn't promote his apostleship. It's not by accident that later on in 1 Corinthians, Paul would write, "For I am the least of all the apostles and do not even deserve to be called apostle, but by the grace of God, I am what I am." And then Paul includes this guy, Sosthenes. Sosthenes was also mentioned in Acts chapter 18 in Corinth. Paul was in trouble for talking about Jesus before the Roman leader, a guy named Gallio. And this happens in Corinth, and we're told, then the crowd there turned on Sosthenes, the synagogue leader, and they beat him in front of the proconsul, and Gallio showed no concern whatever. I mean, what a strange community. There's tent makers, carpenters, slaves, and guys getting beaten up. Really? And of all places, in Corinth? And Paul says, to the church of God in Corinth, together with all those everywhere who call on the name of the Lord Jesus, their Lord and ours. And that's really unique that he would say that, not just to the people there in Corinth, but to everyone else also. In other words, hey, Corinth, you're not all that. What matters is not that you're in Corinth. What matters is that somehow, Christ is in you. And this is just unbelievable. When they would send letters back then, in ancient times, they would always start with this word, caring, karen. And it meant just greetings. And Paul tweaks it, and instead he writes, charis, grace to you, and peace is shalom. Peace is, today we would say, it's total flourishing. It's total blessing from God. You didn't earn it. You didn't acquire it. You didn't trade for it. You didn't compete for it. But he's saying you need it. And sometimes when you live in Corinth, you tend to forget that. And we do too. And yet it's this grace. It's this unearned, undeserved love and forgiveness from a lowly carpenter who died as a condemned criminal. This grace, this is what defines you. This is who you really are. This grace from this Savior Jesus Christ, this is, in the end, all that ever really matters. It's not the stuff that our world boasts about that matters at all. It's not being in Corinth, or its equivalent today. That doesn't make for a real life. It is instead being in Christ. That is who you are. This is all that really matters. This identity is a gift that God gives to you, and it's placed on you in your baptism. You've been made God's child, God's daughter, God's son by his gift. He's your father. He loves you. You're in Christ. Grace came to a city called Corinth. And grace has come to a small city in Ohio called Amherst. And this Jesus life is so different from the killing it life of our world around us. Jesus calls you to just humble yourself, to confess your sin, to let go of the need to prove yourself or advance yourself or promote yourself or save yourself, and just let grace come. Jesus offers you real life, his humble grace. It's transformed individuals and marriages and families and whole cultures, and his grace can change your life too. And in God's eyes, this life of humbly receiving grace from Jesus, this is the life that is truly killing it. So in the meantime, what do I do with my pride? What do I do with my selfishness and my stubborn ego and my deceit, my apathy to others? What do I do with my anger and my bitterness and my sinful self, with the evil that's not just around me, but the evil that's also inside of me? What do? I'm killing it. I'm killing it. By the power of God living in me, I and you are in Christ. God's grace lives in you, and it's a new way of life, a life of killing it. Amen. Direct your attention to the screens right now.
Scales. They can IQ you and run you through their rigorous details. They can do their best to rate you and they'll place you on the charts and then back it up with scientific smarts. But there's more to what's your worth than what their human eyes can see. God made you in his image when he formed you in his hands. And he looks at you with mercy and he sees you through his love. You're his child and that will always be enough. For there's more to what you're worth than you could ever. Oh,
crucial at the end. Let's join together in a prayer as we confess our needs and we confess our sins to God, and together we pray. Lord, we come to you today in need of forgiveness. We have believed the words of false prophets who have led us into selfish materialism and empty ambition. Forgive the sins of our fallen condition. We have believed the words of those who have told us that we can change ourselves with wealth, pleasure, and status. Forgive us for following these false gods. Give us courage and strength to follow in your way alone, Lord Jesus. Amen. Dear friends, God's word declares to us, if you have been united with him like this in his death, you will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. Your sin was put to death in Christ's crucifixion, and you were given new life when he rose again. And this is made personally yours when this promise was put on you in baptism. In the place and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I announce that you are forgiven all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to pause right now and gather today's offerings. And as we do that, just a word to our guests who are with us. Please don't feel obligated to participate in the offering. Really, we mean that. You know, we're glad that you're with us, and that's your gift to us and to God. So don't feel like we invited you here to get your money, okay? That's not the deal. So we're glad you're with us. And while they're gathering today's gifts, you can put the white card and the yellow card if you have a prayer request in there. And a few things I want to mention. Again, welcome everybody. Welcome to guests who are joining us by worship. And our guest, pianist, Jennifer Belmont. We're glad to have her with us. Jennifer's a mom of one of our preschool kids. So we kind of started chit-chatting and found out. And so this is wonderful to have live piano music. And okay, great. A couple things I want to share with you is our community care team is gathering hats and gloves and scarves for Amherst school children. And that will be happening today, next Sunday, and the Sunday after that. And they're gathering, green and yellow, that's the Amherst Comet colors, right? Yeah. And also black, white, too. And you can bring them and put them in a box in the lobby area, in the narthex. And so that would be great. That helps Amherst kids. We've been trying to really connect with the schools and really be a blessing to the schools. 3 weeks from today is Sunday, February the 28th, and there will be one service. Now, this doesn't affect you too much. It'll be at 10 o'clock. It'll be the same time that you're here. But there's no 8:30 service that day. But afterwards, we invite you to stay because we're going to have a meal together. Let's see the next slide, please. And the, oop, okay, we missed that one. Here's what's going on. The next, after the church service, we're having a meal, and the meal is a chili or soup cook-off and a pie bake-off. And the first prize for the chili or soup or the pie, each category, is a $50 first prize gift. So get out your best effort, your best prize, you know, and we're going to go around and sample all of these. I mean, that's winter food, right? Hot soup, hot chili, and pie. And doesn't get much better than that. I mean, if you went to Cleveland, you got these taste test things. You got to pay $50 just to get in the door. But this is free, okay? So hot dog, come and join us for that. And that's just in a few weeks. There's an easel out in the lobby area there, you know, out in the, you're coming out, and you can sign up for, you know, yeah, I'm coming, or yeah, I'm coming, and then there's another one, I'm bringing a chili or a soup, or I'm going to do the pie, enter that, and some other things. So sign up so we know how many is set for, and join us for that. That will be pretty cool. All right. Now, I mean, pretty warm, because it's winter, right? So, okay. Enough of that nonsense. So let's stand and let's continue as we proclaim our faith in our statement of faith today. And together we speak, we believe in God our Father, who created the world in power and love, and whose character is reflected in the complexity and beauty of all creation. We believe in Jesus Christ, who is both real God and human. His life, his teachings, his miracles, his death, and his Easter resurrection combined to provide true forgiveness and life for all eternity. His strength empowers our weakness. His love covers our failures, and his sacrifice forgives all our sin. We can trust him as our friend and brother, our Savior and Lord. We believe in the Holy Spirit. We believe that the Holy Spirit is present with us and lives within each Christ follower. He continues to call people to himself and build up the family of God. Through him, we have the power to stand against all adversity, and we look forward to the final day when we will live with God in heaven. Let's bow our heads in prayer. God, we thank you that you love us so much, and you've given us true, real, meaningful life, and it's found as a free gift, as your grace in Jesus Christ. God, we come to you today, and we lift up people who are in need, and also celebrate with those who celebrate. We're blessed with Margaret Urich, who celebrates the birth of a great-grandson, Ryan Christopher Stryker, who was born on New Year's Day. Thank you for that little life, for your ongoing creation of life. And we pray that you be with him and with his mother and parents, and bless and keep them and bring him up to know Jesus, and bless the family as they strive to do that. God, we ask you to be with people who are sick, like Don Lamoureux, who's back in the hospital, for Sandy Long's great niece, Emma, who will have surgery on her leg. She's in a lot of pain. We pray that the surgery goes great and that you ease the pain for her. Be with Coralie as she's in pain after having broken ribs, and we pray that that heals up. For Tim, who's in hospice care, and Edna, for Elijah, and Jerry, who's in the middle of chemotherapy, for Lori and Brian, who has cancer, for Paxton and Heather and Pat, Sherry, Chris, and Pat, all of them dealing with cancer, be with them, God. Doctors and medical teams, they've got skill and knowledge, and we pray that you use that for their healing, but also be with them, that they know that they're in your care, that you haven't abandoned them, that you love them, you're with them, and you'll work for good always. And God, we ask you also to be with people who celebrate their lives, their birthdays this week: Jesse Barron, Juliet Lazuski, Robert Zime, Dave Timms, Dorothy Barker, Ken Moore, Olivia Hargreaves, Rob Draga, and John Schick. Thank you for them, for their life and the blessings you've given in the past, and we pray that you continue that, that they would find fullness of life in Jesus. And we ask this, and there are other things in our hearts and minds we bring to you as Christ taught us to pray: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God your Heavenly Father and the indwelling presence of God the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Let's join in singing, Lord, Reign in Me.